Welcome you to this morning prayer here at St. John's Episcopal Church. We're going to begin just for a few minutes with Tish playing a prelude. And so I invite you just to sit in your home and to be quiet for a moment and to prepare for worship. Hymn this morning is going to be hymn 508, Breathe on Me, Breath of God, and we're fortunate this morning not only to have Tish play for us, but Bill Reeves is here, and so if you're able to and you have a hymn, he's given the whoop 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 sign, so if you are able to, turn to 508 and we will sing Breathe on Me, Breath of God.
Breathe on me, breath.
continue on page 76 of the Red Book of Common Prayer. There it says Lent, and I will read that first sentence under Lent. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Then turn to page 79. Dearly beloved, we've come together in the presence of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, to set forth His praise, to hear His holy word, and to ask for ourselves and on behalf of others those things that are necessary for our life and our salvation. And so that we may prepare ourselves in heart and mind to worship Him, let us kneel in silence and with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins that we may obtain forgiveness by His infinite goodness and mercy. God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. If you're able, I invite you to stand. Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Now turning to page 82, there at the bottom, we will say together the Jubilate. Be joyful in the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before His presence with a song. Know this, the Lord Himself is God. He Himself has made us, and we are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving, go into His courts with praise, give thanks to Him and call upon His name. For the Lord is good, His mercy is everlasting, and His faithfulness endures from age to age. Our psalm this morning is Psalm 130. Psalm 130 is found on page 770-something. I'm not sure just yet. Nope, it's in the 180s. All right, Psalm 130 is found on page 784. Let us say this together. Out of the depths have I called you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears consider well the voice of my supplication. If you, Lord, were to note what is done amiss, O Lord, who could stand? For there is forgiveness with you, therefore you shall be feared. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits for Him. In His word is my hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than watchmen in the morning. More than watchmen for the morning. O Israel, wait for the Lord, for with the Lord there is mercy, with Him there is plenteous redemption, and He shall redeem Israel from all their sins. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. I invite you to be seated for the lesson. The first lesson is from Ezekiel. Special guest.
A reading from Ezekiel. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and He brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were very many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live. And you shall know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as I had been commanded, and as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them. But there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, Thus says the Lord God, Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live.' I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, 'Mortal, these bones are the house of Israel. They say our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore prophesy and say to them, Thus says the Lord God, I'm going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Mekenzie. We're going to read a collect together. It is the first song of Isaiah. It's found at the top of page 86. So let us read this collect together. "Surely it is God who saves me. I will trust in him and not be afraid. For the Lord is my stronghold and my sure defense, and he will be my savior. Therefore you shall draw water with rejoicing from the springs of salvation. And on that day you shall say, 'Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make his deeds known among the peoples. See that they remember that his name is exalted. Sing the praises of the Lord, for he has done great things, and this is known in all the world. Cry aloud, inhabitants of Zion, ring out your joy, for the great one in the midst of you is the Holy One of Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen." All right, our second reading is from Romans chapter 8, verses 6 through 11.
"To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, indeed it cannot, and those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, you are in the Spirit. Since the Spirit of God dwells in you, anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit that dwells in you." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Alright, let us turn to, again, to page 86. We're going to say the second song of Isaiah, Canticle 10. "Seek the Lord while he wills to be found. Call upon him when he draws near. Let the wicked forsake their ways, and the evil ones their thoughts. And let them turn to the Lord, and he will have compassion, and to our God, for he will richly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as rain and snow fall from the heavens, and return not again, but water the earth, bringing forth life and giving growth, seed for sowing and bread for eating. So is my word that goes forth from my mouth, it will not return to me empty, but it will accomplish that which I have purposed and prosper in that for which I sent it. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Our gospel reading is from John. It's chapter 11, verses 1 through 45. So we're going to be here for a moment as I read this gospel. Now, a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death, rather it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Accordingly, though, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. After having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble, because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble, because the light is not in them." After saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now, Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house consoling her saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and his feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Lord Jesus Christ, so quiet the noise of our lives that we can hear your voice. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. There are a few things in life that are more devastating than the feeling of being abandoned. Sometimes it's happened in a maybe not as serious but still important way, like a child who is left at school and not picked up by a parent, or perhaps either parent, or there perhaps is a miscommunication between parents, as has been true with both of my children whom you heard read today. Other times, it's by parents who either severely neglect or outright abandon their children. That's something, if you've been with me for years, you know that I have dealt with that, and it's not very easy, and the reality of it is it leaves a mark on both your psyche and especially on your soul. Perhaps worst of all is feeling abandoned by God. There are very few people I know who at one time or another felt like God was not listening or responding. And you could see it in their affect and in their words when they expressed anger. Like, "I've been praying and praying and God's simply not answering my prayers." We see a glimpse of this today in the gospel. And I love this passage. It's a long one, but they use a shorter portion of it when we do funerals. And the second paragraph says that Jesus was summoned before Lazarus had even died, and it says he stayed a couple more days, and then they headed to Judea, so we don't even know how long it took for him to get there. But when he finally gets there, we know that Lazarus has been in the tomb 4 days. One of the things that I love about this passage is Martha. I love when she comes out, because you have a contrast of Martha and Mary both saying these exact same words, but they say, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." And I don't know why, but you know, you saw Mary said it second. She's kneeling at the feet of the Lord, and Martha is the busy one, and she comes up, and I don't know if she was mournful or irritated, but for whatever reason in my mind, she's got her hands on her hip, and she's lecturing him with her head shaking and all this. "If you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died." But I don't know exactly what's going on, but she shows great faith still when she says afterwards, "Even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." For those few days, I wonder if Martha and Mary both, in their disappointment that Jesus wasn't there, didn't feel a bit abandoned. The rest of us are probably more like the Israelites that we heard in the reading from Ezekiel. They have been exiled to the land of the Babylonians, and they have lost their homes, they've lost their worship, their space, their culture, their clothes, and all that makes them Jewish. And part of our time right now is we're going through all these things that we're losing, all these things that make us who we are as Americans, as Texans, as people in this community. And the people then are longing to be home in their land, for things to be back to normal, and after prayerful time and following prayer after prayer after prayer, God seemingly has not answered them. But one of the things that God did do is God called Ezekiel. And Ezekiel came to preach to them, and at first, just like most of the prophets do, he chided them for their sinful behavior, that which led to them being exiled. And then he starts to share a message of forgiveness and of restoration. And that is the part of this message today that I love. God gives Ezekiel his vision of restoration of the exiled people, and he carries him to this valley of dry bones. We sometimes talk about dry bones dancing. In the midst of feeling hopeless and abandoned, God shows the prophet the impossible. And then God asks this prophet, is it possible to restore these people? I love Ezekiel's answer. I don't know if he's faithful or if he's just saying, you know, what he thinks God wants to hear. But he says, oh Lord God, only you know. God proclaims the intention of bringing life to that which is dead. And so all of a sudden you start to see all these random bones start to come together, and ligaments and tendons start to hold these bones together, and muscle starts developing, and then skin covers the muscle. And finally, just like the first man in the Garden of Eden, God breathes into these corpses and they come to life. We're living in a crazy time. I can't tell you how many people have said to me, this, if I had a nickel for this, I've never seen anything like it. That's what everybody keeps saying. If I had a nickel for that, I'd be a rich man at this point. And we don't know the future, and that's part of the difficulty, and the norms keep changing. Every time we think we've got something to stand on, another day they push it out, or something changes, or we need to separate even more. And it seems our governmental leaders sometimes are grasping at straws, and I know actually all of them, they're actually doing their best in the midst of the unknown. And even our medical professionals, those who seem to forecast what's going on, they always forecast the worst, which seems to create anxiety and stress in us. And again, what are they doing? They're doing their jobs. They're doing that which is to help us all. But our way of life, of work, of shopping, our toilet paper shortage make this all seem like it's headed down the drain, doesn't it? When is this all going to end? Lord, help us, we pray. And yet, in the midst of this difficulty, one of the most amazing things that I've heard is more people talk about being prayerful than any time I can remember. And graciousness in that. Praying for me and for you and for the world, for healing, for help. And not one person yet has said to me, where's God? Where is God in all this? Why has God abandoned us? However, I can tell you this. Stretch this out a couple more months or stretch this out to a year, and people are going to start losing their minds, right? They will feel abandoned and hopeless and lost. Civility will quickly take a back seat to anger in those shows that we see, the news where people are fighting over things at the grocery store, will become a reality. And if everything was taken from us, we too would feel abandoned. This vision of dry bones dancing reminds us, keep praying. God is listening. God is at work in ways that we cannot see. And God is going to take this dry skeleton of a world that we live in and put it back together through the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So don't give up hope. God will help us. Amen. As a reminder that God is going to help us, Bill Reeves is here today to sing one of his favorite hymns, Dry Bones. And so I invite you to enjoy that and remember God is at work.
This is a fun little song. Many of you know it. Tish picked it out. We found an arrangement that this might suit everybody today. So I hope you enjoy this version of Dry Bones. Ezekiel cried them, dry bones, Ezekiel cried them, dry bones, Ezekiel.
Awesome. Thank you, Bill. All right, I invite you, if you will, to stand with me, and let's turn to page 96. If you're able to stand, I invite you to do so, and we will continue with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And there at the bottom of page 97, we will say, Suffrage A, I do the V's, you do the R's. Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Clothe your ministers with righteousness. Let your people sing with joy. Give peace, O Lord, in all the world, for only in you can we live in safety. Lord, keep this nation under your care and guide us in the way of justice and truth. And let your way be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. And create in us clean hearts, O God, and sustain us with your Holy Spirit. The collect for today, if you wanted to look, it's on page 219 in the Book of Common Prayer. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you alone can bring into order the unruly wills and affections of sinners. Grant your people grace to love what you command and desire what you promise, that among the swift and varied changes of the world, our hearts may surely there be fixed where true joys are to be found through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And then there on the bottom of page 99, we'll pray together the Collect for Peace. O God, the author of peace and lover of concord, to know you is eternal life, and to serve you is perfect freedom. Defend us, your humble servants, in all assaults of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in your defense, may not fear the power of any adversaries, through the might of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And then if you'll turn one more page, we're going to say there, the third one, right there in the middle of page 100 together. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers, which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. And there at the top of page 101, it asks us for intercessions and thanksgiving, so I invite you to spend a moment and to pray for those in this world that you love and that you care for and that you know are sick or in need of God's help. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. I'm going to pray for you again, the prayer for the pandemic that my friend Andrew Odell sort of adapted from the Wesley Commons Chaplain's Prayer. May we who are merely inconvenienced remember those whose lives are at stake and for whom you were gladly inconvenienced when you came to earth, O Lord. May we who have no risk factors remember the most vulnerable, for whom you made yourself vulnerable as a little child, O Lord. May we who have the luxury of working from home remember those who must choose between preserving their health or making their rent, and for whom you labored as a lowly carpenter, O Lord. May we who have the flexibility to care for our children when their schools close remember those who have no options, calling to mind your tender words, suffer little children and forbid them not to come unto me, for of such is the kingdom of heaven. May we who have to cancel our trips remember those who have no safe place to go, as was true to you when Herod sought to take your life, O Lord. And may we who are losing our monies in the tumult of economic markets remember that those who have no margin at all, as you remember them when you told your disciples in the feeding of the 5,000, you give them something to eat. May we who settle for a quarantine at home remember those who have no home, just as you, O Son of Man, have no place to lay your head. And as fear grips our country, let us remember the words of the angels who said, "Fear not." Let us choose love. And during this time when we cannot physically wrap our arms around each other, let us find ways to be the loving embrace of God to our neighbors. As the Samaritan in your great parable, who had a compassion like unto your own. For all these things we ask in the mighty name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And then let us continue with the great, or the general thanksgiving found there in the middle of page 101, saying together, Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love and the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. And then the prayer of St. Chrysostom. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth and in the age to come, life everlasting. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. And may the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now our closing hymn is hymn 498, Beneath the Cross of Jesus. 498.
Thank you.
concludes our worship, but I did want to share with you a few announcements. So if you are a part of St. John's, I encourage you to continue to listen. Bishop Reed did send out a letter this week. He declared that our corporate worship, this gathering here in this body, is suspended through April. But the good news is that we get to, as Chris Smith would say, we get to worship via the internet. So we will continue to worship this way. Just so you know that next Sunday is Palm Sunday. We have palms being delivered. We're not sure the day they'll be delivered, but we will be able to put some of those outside the church on a table, and we'll let you know via email and e-news what day you can pick those up, and they will be out there for you to get. Easter is coming, and we're going to have both on Palm Sunday and Easter a Holy Eucharist here. And if you haven't ordered lilies, please do so. One of the things that we've said is if you do put in orders, the money for those is going to go to help the New Braunfels Food Bank with all the families that they are serving at this point. Also know that the liturgy for both of those Sundays will be available to you either through our e-news or on the website, so please do look for those. The vestry also sent out a letter about giving, and if you're able to, great. If things have changed, I encourage you, please do call Desiree and let her know. And if you didn't read the bishop's letter, which I encourage you to do, you can go to dwtx.org and see it, or you can even find it on our website, stjohnsnb.com. But one of the things that he has done is he suspended the April apportionment. And one of the things, I read that and I thought that's great, and that's nice to do for churches. But at the same time, I thought, you know, part of this is who we are, and in the midst of this, I still would love to be able to send something to the diocese just to say thank you, but this is who we are as well. Lastly, I wanted to let you know that Alice Jewell, who's a member of this church and the leader at the McKenna Foundation, has put out an immediate release that the McKenna Foundation has committed $50,000 to create a Comal Emergency Relief Fund and to help those families in the crisis. And they're raising money, trying to get an additional $250,000 to support the community. And if you're able to, know that that's a tax-deductible gift, and any amount to help them reach that goal would be great. And you can do that online at the website nbcommunityfoundation.org. That's nbcommunityfoundation.org. And I encourage you to do that to help those families in crisis. Lastly, I wanted to show you today, this is black. I wore a purple one that matches Lent. The other ones are called the stole. This one's called a tippet. And a tippet is one of the things that a priest wears when they are doing morning prayer. Last week I wore a stole. You can do that. But this week it was a tippet. All right, I pray the Lord blesses you and that you are safe and that you have a great opportunity to go out and to love and serve people in this community. As last week, my family watched a movie. Tell me if you know what movie this is. Brian Johnson writes, "Dear Mr. Vernon, we accept the fact that we had to sacrifice a whole Saturday in detention for whatever it was we did wrong, but we think you're crazy to make an essay telling you who we think we are. You see us as you want to see us. In the simplest of terms and the most convenient definitions, what we found out is that each one of us is a brain, Andrew Clark in an athlete, Allison Reynolds in a basket case, Claire Standish, a princess, John Bender in a criminal, Brian Johnson, does that answer your questions? Severely yours, what's the answer?"